Okay, so everybody says, why are you making your own drill bits? I actually, through the years, have made all kinds of drill bits. Occasionally, if we're making some pins, bigger pins than this, for earthmoving equipment, you will end up having to drill a hole maybe that far down inside a pin for a grease cavity to get grease into them. And I don't always have a commercial drill bit long enough. I make all kinds of drill bits for log house builders when they got to drill wiring holes through logs and things like that. You can, but you know, if I'm trying to drill a hole down a $1,000 pin, I'm not going to weld a drill bit on the end of a rod and risk having it break off in there. Yeah, you know.
When you're joining, it's better to break it than not weld it.
Now the other thing that I would do, if I'm making a drill bit for myself to drill a pin, I'm not going to make it out of mild steel. I'm going to make it out of a piece of drill rod, whether it be oil hardened drill rod or water hardened drill rod. You know, for all it costs, you're not going to screw around trying to make it. I'm just doing this to show you that carburizing works. So, does anybody want to see a picture of how you do this before I do it, in case you want to do it yourself?
Sure.
Okay, cool. I did the blackboard here. So, I'm going to let Lloyd check the size of the hole when we're done here, because I'm going to try and make a drill bit without measuring it. It's going to drill a 3/8 hole. So we have 5/16 round material, so I'm going to flatten the end of the material to 3/8 of width, but I'm not going to make it perfectly flat. What I'm going to do is I'm going to forge it into a parallelogram. If you look at the end of the material, I want to forge it into a parallelogram. Okay, then when I twist the drill bit, we end up with the raised land on the end. So the drill bit doesn't tend to bind up in the hole by making it a parallelogram shape. Now, you got to do this in the right way, depend upon whether you want a left-hand drill or a right-hand drill, because some people, like Dan, want drills that turn the opposite direction. If you're trying to drill something...
This will be the land.
That's right. That'll be the land. When we, it'll be very evident after I twist it, but you want to forge it into a parallelogram, and most people end up forging parallelograms when they don't want them. This is what you end up doing. So we're just going to hammer the rod, we're going to make it flat like this, and then we're going to work it on the edges. Now, if I'm making a drill bit, I'm going to drill a pin with my lathe. What I'm going to do is I'm going to forge it into a parallelogram, and then I'm going to file or grind these edges so I have nice sharp corners before I twist and heat treat. But we're going to do this little example. I'm just going to forge it, and I'm going to twist it, and then I'm going to cool it off in water to prove to you that it hasn't got hard, and I'm going to grind and file the edge on it, then I'm going to carburize it, and then we're going to drill through a piece of steel with it. I'm going to make a right-hand drill bit. Forging it like that makes a right-hand drill bit. Okay. Now, everybody says, when do you want a left-handed drill bit? You can take a regular drill, like I drilled through that plate with, do absolutely nothing to it, other than sharpen it backwards. Instead of doing this, do this, sharpen it backwards, and what you end up with is a little bit of a curve cutting it, but you got to run the drill backwards to cut. Why do you do that? The next time Buddy brings something in with a stud broken off in it, sharpen the drill backwards, run your drill backwards. Lots of times when you're drilling it, bring it out. You don't need to buy a left-handed drill bit, just sharpen a regular drill backwards.
But does not push the material into the grease?
No, we do this is not pushing. Yeah, but lots of, you know, you're only trying to drill a little wee bit. It's, okay. You know, your old drills had no twist on them at all. They were just flat spades. Okay. Good balance right there. Thank you. Now usually, before I cool them off, I'll spin them and make sure I got them straight. Most of the time you can get them pretty close. Now if you feel the edge on that Lloyd, like looking at it, it almost feels like a machine. Right? feel the edge of it? Feel the tip of land stands up?
Yes.
Right? So if I can just get my belt sander here, I'll break her down and we'll... I just broke it down there. Now again, back to the drill sharpening thing, you know, we're going to thin the web here. You know, we've got to do all this before we carburize it, because when you carburize stuff, the depth that it's going in is so minute, you don't get a chance to do anything after you carburize.
Thinning up the web on the corner.
Yeah, I'm doing that, and what I'm going to do prove to you that we haven't made this hard. You know, there's guys out there who will tell you you can heat treat mild steel. You can't heat treat mild steel. They sell products called Superquint. No carbon. You can't do it.
You're saying the Superquint stuff doesn't work?
No, it doesn't.
About that for years.
It's
witchcraft.
Yeah, it's, you know what? Maybe you got
a piece, maybe, to be a rocket.
Yeah,
thing?
Maybe you got a piece of material that had a bit more manganese in it, but it's, you need carbon in order to make material.
That's kind of a smoke and mirror show. First guy that's sort of agreed with me.
I'm just squaring up my thinning the web, you see. Before I carburize it, we'll pass it around, let you see. You can virtually reduce the web to nothing.
And that allows your chip to escape easily.
It allows it, and it gives you two more little cutting edges right at the inside. Your drill bit essentially has four. Now if you look at the end of it, two little cutting edges there, and then the two main ones, you know, you thin the web to...
Oh yeah. Yeah. Oh, that looks like 7/16.
I'll let you measure the hole or not. Verniers are sitting top of my lathe.
Serious.
Tell you what.
No, that's awesome.
I will tell you what. If I'm within 10 thousandths of 3/8 of an inch, what do you give me? Okay. So we're gonna carburize it.
Oh yeah.
Okay, so you can heat this up and you can roll it around your carburizing compound. Don't do that, because you end up wasting a bunch. You melt a bunch of this together. Just think of this as flux. So heat your part up and just sprinkle it on, okay? You just need to encase the outside of it. And you can do it multiple times. If you want to get a deeper case, you know, do it 2 or 3 times. It soaks into the surface. Now, in the 1970s, likely before, but in the 70s, if you had a camshaft out of a North American car, a GM or a Ford, whether anybody has noticed this or not, a lot of people used to wonder why nobody was able to answer the question. The camshaft in between the journals would be copper colored. Has anybody seen that?
Yeah.
Seen that? The reason that is, when they made those camshafts, they were forged steel, low carbon steel. They put a copper paint on them between the journals, and then they carburize them. The carburizing won't penetrate that copper, so the only part that got hard was the journals. It didn't get hard in between, so your camshaft wouldn't break off. Then, in 1978, GM came out with the new motor, the 305. Who had a 305 GM motor? Some brilliant metallurgical engineer decided to put a cast iron camshaft in, and they all failed. Everybody that had an early 305 GM, the camshaft ground up, the metal particles went through all the inch, and they didn't warranty on it. It was insane. You know, so anyway, that's one way you can prevent the carburizing from going where you don't want. Another way that a lot of places do, even guys that are making model engines, for example, will make a crankshaft for a model engine, machine it, they will carburize it. They have no control over where the carburizing goes, but when they're done carburizing it, they will put it in vermiculite so it doesn't get hard. Then they will put it back in their lathe and they will machine it all, everything except where they want it hard. It will remove that hard layer, so then when they heat it up and quench it, the only part that gets hard is the parts they haven't machined. You know, if it's a part that's got to offer some flex and not crack and break, you only want one part of it, it's done all the time. Copper is one of the things they put on. The other thing you can put on it is fire clay. You can coat your part in fire clay where you don't want the carbon to penetrate.
Japanese swords.
Exactly, same thing. Okay, so I'll get closer to my heat source here. So, a telltale sign that you've done this right is when you quench it, you should get a distinctive snap in the water. And then when your part comes out of the water, it should be a mousy gray color. If you get that, generally everything's going your way. See the flame now after
sodium flame. I'll get the cyanide on the sodium cyanide. Don't break your beak.
Okay, so we're going to bring it up to color now. Quench it in water. When you carburize things, if it's mild steel, there's no tempering involved. Because the core of the metal, you never change. It's still, you quench it and you're good to go.
when you're heating it up, does it matter what sort of thing you use? Do you go in the forge or?
You can do it in the forge, fine.
So you could do it with a propane torch then?
You wouldn't get enough heat out of a propane torch.
Okay.
No, you wouldn't get enough heat out of a propane torch. It'd
be pretty small.
I don't understand then the fact that you use propane to cut the wood, and it's just to heat the metal up enough for the oxygen.
Yeah, all you gotta do is get the metal to where the reaction will start.
Not hard enough yet?
I didn't like the sound of how it quenched. That's what it's telling you. You want to hear the snap. Did you hear it?
Yeah.
I didn't hear it like I like to hear it. Gray color there in all
of
them?
Yep.
I'm big concern about that if it was high carbon.
Going
in case it's brittle. You know you got some dinner for it, I would be concerned.
Yeah, it's hard to start with that.
What a thought.
I was prepared. I already had a center punch mark and a piece of mild steel. That's the other trick. Center punches? If you guys are working on the fire, instead of grinding a point in your center punch, grind it four-sided. Because what it does is it sends little, especially if it's hot rolled steel, it'll send little stress things out the steel, and you will see your part in the fire. You'll see these little corners coming out there. When it comes out of the fire, you can pick the mark up a lot easier. Okay, the old timers used to do that, eh?
I've seen old center punches
like that, so
they get screwed up.
No, but it's very evident when the scale comes off your material. You see the it's like looking through a gun sight. It's pointing right to.
Yeah.